I could just have everyone's attention for a moment. We will be starting the tribute for Dorothy. Can you all hear me back there or in front? Shortly, so if I could just ask everyone to please find a chair, which I guess you already have. And for those of you with cell phones, if you would just please silence them. Following the service this afternoon, everyone is invited to stay and join the family for a luncheon and to further remember Dorothy. In just a few minutes, we'll be having the family come in. Ready? I'm just going to check and make sure the family is ready. They're going to be coming out here shortly. I guess I'm a little bit like my Auntie Dorothy. It's time. And that comes from being the school teacher in us. The bell rings, those are the chairs, sit down. So she wasn't quite as strict as I was, I don't think. But anyway, I'm just going to make sure that we're all on the same page here. They heard me, see? Could everyone please stand? Thank you. Everyone may be seated. Thank you. At this time, I would like to invite Matthew Dalen, son of longtime family friend Herb Dalen, to come forward as he sings the hymn, How Great Thou Art, as a special gift and tribute to Dorothy. I would like to ask everyone that wants to stand, they're more than welcome to, but it is going to be a lovely tribute, so you're more than welcome to stay seated. Thank you.
Some wonder, consider all the worlds thy hands hath made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. My soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. When I think that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly. Savior God, to thee,
On behalf of the family, I would like to extend a heartfelt thank you, Matthew, for your wonderful tribute. Dorothy would be so very appreciative and full of thanks for your amazing gift you have shared in her memory. It sounded like a choir here today, and I'm sure it was a choir of angels on her behalf joining you. It was beautiful. Everybody can still hear me because I kind of move around here a little bit. Get used to my voice. I've got you here for at least a couple hours. I think they said I was supposed to go 2 hours or 2.5 hours if I could. The older the fiddle, the sweeter the tune, in memory and in honor of Dorothy Rosemary Ryan Muir. Even to your old age, even to your gray hairs, I will carry you. Isaiah 46. Good afternoon, family and friends, and welcome. I would like to take a moment to extend a personal welcome to everyone joining us today via live stream. This is the first time for me to go public at a service, so if it's a little awkward, that's why I'm a little nervous here. I believe I've had the good fortune of knowing most of you today, but for those of you whom I haven't met, I'm Dorothy's niece, Lorraine. Nicknamed by Annie Dorothy as Rainy, I was her favorite, but as we all know, Annie Dorothy didn't have any favorites. I'm very honored to be here to pay tribute to a lady that I have been blessed to call my aunt, and who has touched so many lives in her own unique and special way, and who made such a positive impact in my own life. We will truly miss Annie Dorothy for her loving ways, knowledge, unending wisdom, and sharing God's word. Just like music, our lives have different parts to our songs. As we go through life, we are creating our own lyrics and our own music. The intro is when we are born, our song starts. We have a blank piece of sheet music just waiting to be written. Every intro in each person's song will start differently. The world needs each person's unique melody, which makes so many different types of music being sung. As we grow, we write our life verses. Verse 1, childhood. 2, schooling. 3, our career. 4, marrying and having a family. And on go the verses. Each person's verses will look different. Your song may have only 2 verses, while another person's will have many. Some great songs have the shortest lyrics, so don't compare your melody to someone else. Remember, it is perfectly fine and wonderful to be just you. Your chorus is your life's theme that will keep repeating over and over. It should be the best part of your song. The theme may change with age, but it is still yours to write. Your chorus may be upbeat, slow, or a mixture of both, and that makes you unique. The people in your life can't wait to hear what you have written by just being you. The coda is the end of the song. Every great song has a great ending. Live your life and continue to write your song. Fill up your pages of music, let your song tell your story, and at the ending, be the best part. Others will hear it and want to listen to your song again and again because of the wonderful song that you wrote. Annie Dot's song most certainly went to the number one on the charts. Although her song has ended, her melody will linger on in the hearts of those who knew and loved her. We are all together today for a celebration of life in honor of a wonderful lady, Dorothy Rosemary Muir, more fondly known to many as Dot. We are here to remember her 96 and a half year journey through life. In Auntie Dorothy's own words, I've had a wonderful journey, a terrific life, a great time loving family and friends, and God. A quote by Chief Seattle, take only memories, leave only footprints, and Annie Dot certainly did just that. She'll be remembered for her kind heart, nurturing personality, and unconditional love and unwavering faith. Today, as we celebrate Dorothy's life and say our goodbyes, it isn't easy knowing that there's yet another link in our family chain missing. But it is with love and faith that we know as God calls us home, one by one, the chain will be linked again. Dorothy had been in God's waiting room for the last little while, but we all know that she was truly prepared for her journey to her eternal home when she was called by her Creator and reunited with all the family and friends waiting for her arrival. What a grand reunion they will all be having. I'm a little bit jealous. I think it's safe to say her prayer in the last while went something like this. Hello, Jesus. I'm ready to come home anytime you call. I told Annie Dodd on a few occasions that I was praying she would live to be 100, and her response was, "Honey, you can cut that prayer back. A few months will be fine." And we had a good giggle, but truthfully, I never did decrease the number. Obviously, God had her pre-booked her flight home, and on March 9th, surrounded and comforted by the love of her family, Annie Dorothy passed away into God's arms at the age of 96 plus years, carrying with her the love of those who loved her. God has her in his hands. We have her in our hearts. Dorothy looked at life as a gift from God, and we know she wouldn't want us to be sad. The last visit I shared with Annie Dot, these were her words. "When I'm gone, no tears, just joy. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. And she knows I'm a ball baby." There's a short story that reminds me of Annie Dot's faith, strength, and her country roots. There was an elderly woman who was becoming weak and somewhat frail and was sitting in her chair. A friend inquired whether or not she was afraid. "Afraid of what?" the elderly woman asked. "Please tell me honestly, do you fear death and crossing over to the other side?" "Oh, goodness, no. Why would I?" replied the woman gently. "I belong to a father who owns land on both sides. Family is like music, high notes, low notes, but always beautiful when sung together." Dorothy was a cherished daughter, loving wife, a truly amazing mom, and the kind of grandma and great-grandma that any child could ever hope to have, and a much-loved sister, aunt, cousin, and a loyal friend to many. I would like to take a moment to extend everyone's love and heartfelt sympathy to Dorothy's family, who are missing her deeply and treasuring her memory. Dorothy will be forever loved and remembered by her family, sister Mert Sandy, son Bruce Muir and wife Anne, daughter Kendra, husband George, grandchildren Riley, wife Kristen, Kelly, husband Mike, Kyla, husband Mike, Lindsay, husband Sean, and daughter-in-law Corey, great-grandchildren Brett, Brooke, Connor, Cadence, Leo, Georgia, Violet, and Hugh, as well as many nieces, nephews, cousins, and friends. Dorothy was predeceased by her loving husband Bert, son Larry Muir, daughter Edlyn, grandsons Chris Muir and Brady Fournier, siblings Patty Washen, Bill Ryan, Doreen Hopkins, Kate Young, as well as many other loving and special brother and sister-in-laws, special family members, and lifelong friends. This is the message that Annie Dorothy wanted to leave with her family. "To my children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, for all the things my hands have ever held, you were by far the greatest. Your existence made my world brighter than I could ever have imagined. You outgrew my lap, but you never outgrew my heart and my love. Always remember, be bold enough to use your voice, brave enough to listen to your heart, strong enough to live the life you've always imagined. Believe in yourself as much as I have believed in you. I know I won't be there for the rest of your life, but I can promise you I will love you every day from heaven." On behalf of the Muir family today, thank you for being here, showing your love and support by remembering with us the life of our dear mom, grandma, and great-grandma. We would like to express our sincere gratitude for the cards, phone calls, texts, and the expressions of sympathy we have received. Your gestures are so greatly appreciated. Dorothy's love and devotion to our Creator, her family, and her friends came first in her life, but she also had many passions as well. It's hard to narrow them down to just a couple. She loved music, she loved birds, and maybe that's because they were both musicians. Was a talented violinist, a teacher, an avid reader, gardener, volunteer, loved Mother Nature and the simplicity of life, and of course the list goes on. So the metaphors, pictures, and the chapters in her life story today will hopefully reflect on the lady she was. Her faith, moral compass, and the message she would want to leave you with. It's always hard to turn the page of a book when you know someone won't be in the next chapter. We have all been privileged to be a part of many of Dorothy's chapters. Her ending quote might read, "To all who have touched my life, you have contributed in making it one that I was truly proud of." As many of you know, Annie Dorothy was a school teacher and started her career at the young age of 17. She influenced the path many of us are on today. She was a gifted teacher in and out of the classroom. She built self-esteem, confidence, changed lives with her knowledge and wisdom on many different subjects, not just academically. She was a beacon of light and created bonds of love and respect throughout her years. One of Dorothy's special gifts was her capability to have diverse conversations with people of all ages. So I thought the poem, "Why God Made Teachers," was so fitting and truly explains the teacher she was. God understood our thirst for knowledge and our need to be guided by someone with wisdom. He needed a heart of compassion, of encouragement, and patience. Someone who would accept a challenge regardless of the opposition. Someone who could see potential and believe in the best of others. So he made teachers like Dorothy, an example of a loving and godly teacher. And because of Dorothy's love of gardening and her faith, I wanted to share the following metaphor as well, as it conveys the love she had for our Creator and gardening. Life is like a garden. Everyone's garden is different, so is everyone's life. We each have a time and a place in which to create who we are. Each garden and each life comes with different soil, some sandy, rocky, plush, or poor, but every garden in life has the potential to be beautiful. Seeds need to be watered, planted, and tended. So it is with our lives. We need to water and prayer with fertilized with God's word. Every life needs to be loved and nurtured in order to grow. Just as a garden needs weeded, we needed to pull the weeds in our lives. Plants need both sunlight and rain to grow. We too need both sunlight to recognize the positive in our lives and rain to experience in the harder times that make us stronger. One of the best lessons learned from gardening is that all life is dependent upon the lives of others. A guide for gardening God's way and Annie Dorothy's way. Plant 3 rows of peas, peace of mind, peace of heart, peace of soul. Plant 4 rows of squash, squash criticism, gossip, squash indifference, and selfishness. Plant 5 rows of lettuce. Let us be faithful, kind, and compassionate. Let us love one another, and let us be forgiving. No garden should be without turnips. Turn up to help one another. Turn up to volunteer, and turn up the music, sing and dance. Water freely with patience, and cultivate with love. There is much fruit in our gardens. We reap what we sow. We must not forget to plant one of the most important plants, time. Time for God in prayer, time to study His word, time for family and friends, time for work and rest, and of course, time for fun. What a beautiful garden we can all grow. We plant seeds every day in the world, and every thought we think, and word we speak, and actions we take. Annie Dorothy, I hope you will take comfort in knowing that the many seeds of life you planted along your journey will continue to grow as your legacy lives on. Just as we are thrilled to see the seeds that are planted start growing and then become beautiful plants, so God becomes excited when He sees His seeds grow in the garden of our spiritual lives. As seedlings of God, we barely blossom on earth, but we fully bloom and flower in heaven. As the Creator brings each of us into His internal garden, as we promised in God's word, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Eternal life is a gift. It was prompted by God's love. It was purchased by Jesus. May we all open the doors of our hearts and welcome Him in. At this time, I'll be sharing the 23rd Psalm. It was one of Annie Dorothy's favorites. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He waketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for His namesake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'd like to ask Bruce and Kendra to come forward, if you would at this time, or would you rather after I'm done my eulogy, whichever's more comfortable.
I Thank you, Lorraine, for the lovely eulogy. Very
beautiful. And thanks, everyone, for coming. Mean a lot to Mom.
We'll put the glasses on first. So anyway, thanks so much for everybody being here. It means a lot. We were just kind of reminiscing the other day about how probably many of you have been out to Mom and Dad's at Pinky's Palace. And the first thing that Mom did when you came in was she gave you a name tag, because that was kind of her thing. And I kind of understand now that I'm getting a bit older why she did that. So we just wanted to say that there are some song lyrics, I don't know if all of you are familiar with them, by John Cougar Mellencamp, went something like, life goes on long after the living is done. And I think Mom truly felt that, and she was ready for her wings, and she was ready to go. Do you want to?
Oh, you go ahead. Okay. You're doing a great job.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. Anyway, I just wanted to say Mom was the most kind, loving, generous person, as all you probably know. And she made us feel like... Okay, you start reading.
Yeah. Well, I got to get my glasses then.
Here, I'll lend them to you.
Okay.
I think I can do it. Okay.
Okay.
Anyway.
You go ahead.
Okay, I'll go ahead. Okay. All right. Anyway, that made you feel like you were the most important person in the universe. She just made you feel so special all the time. She encouraged a foundation of confidence and security in every person she met. And she loved generously. She gave generously of her time and her heart. She was a woman of faith, and I really truly feel that faith sustained her throughout her whole life. And we were all blessed to call this woman Mom. And truly believe she left the world a better place.
Yeah, so we were very fortunate to have our mother for 96 and a half years. her love and concern for her family knew no limits. She was always with us to guide and support us through whatever came our way. Let's be honest, we needed some guidance along the way. We weren't always perfect children. You'd never know that now, but sometimes we did stray.
Yeah.
Anyway, even though Mom's gone from this earth, we know she's still watching over us, and we're still going to be careful not to stray too far. We know she'll come back and put us in the right direction somehow.
So once again, thank you so much for being here. It means the world to everybody. Thank you.
Thank you both so very much. I know it's not ever easy trying to talk about our loved ones in the past tense, but we know they leave us a lot of love and memories at the end. So I'm just going to now do Annie Dorothy's eulogy of her life. I only have 14 pages, so it shouldn't take long. I do put them big so I can see, because my eyes are getting a little old as well, hence the gray hair. Well, family and friends, it's time for a bit of history and storytelling. Although it is absolutely impossible to tell someone's life story that has lived such a long and eventful life in a few paragraphs, I'll try to retrace a bit as seen through the eyes of family and friends and some of Dorothy's personal recollections of her own lifetime memories. Dorothy was born in a small rural hospital in Nanton in southern Alberta on September the 11th, 1927. She was the fourth child of Jim and Madeline Ryan and was little sister to Patricia, Bill, and Doreen, and big sister to Kate and Mert. She grew up in a large family and was raised on a small ranch in the foothills south of Nanton. Dot was just a baby when her grandparents came over from England to Canada for a visit, and upon experiencing the joy of their grandchildren, they stayed and called Canada home and lived with the Ryan clan in their two-story house in the hills. For those of you who remember the TV series, I know we're dating back, but I think most of us here will, TV series The Waltons, well, that pretty much gives you a vivid picture of Auntie Dorothy's home life growing up. Having been born and raised during the Depression and World War II years, life had its share of hard times for many, and Auntie Dot and her family were no exception. Growing up in those years, there wasn't a lot materialistically, but love, faith, family, and friends sustained and supported most families through those hard years. Auntie Dot learned the meaning of hard work, and those work ethics followed her throughout her life. She grew up in the era of one-room schoolhouses, Christmas concerts, Santa Claus bringing treat bags, which was the highlight of the school year, followed by a family dance. The band consisted of local neighbors who provided the music. These events brought many special memories back to all the Ryans and the children too. Ironically, in later years, Dorothy and a group of friends played for those dances in the same rural schools. Friendships were formed during those school years at the McEwen School, and the bonds made lasted a lifetime, no matter the distance between them. Lack of amenities, both at home and school, were absent according to today's standards. Kerosene lanterns, ice boxes, and outhouses were the norm. Mum and Auntie Dorothy used to joke about having running water. They say it all depended on how fast you could run and fill a bucket and get back. Dorothy started school at age 6 and found it very easy. She was a keen learner, thus combining grades and skipping grades. It didn't run in the family on my side anyway. By the time she was 12, she had passed out of grade 9. Dorothy started her political career at the ripe old age of 10 or thereabout. She would stand on her favorite rock on the hill at the home place, promoting her talents as a supporter of, I'll give you 1 minute to think of the party, you're right, social credit. So throughout her young adult life and childhood, she became a political activist. Dorothy spent a lot of time determined to better the lot of ordinary people. Politics for Dorothy was a very important part of her life, and she was a proud member and staunch supporter of the Social Credit Party. And you'd better have a darn good reason why you wouldn't support them, or her gentleness took a bit stronger approach. Without question, each member of the family bought a Social Credit membership as soon as we were old enough to vote. Kendra and I can attest, we were up at 6 o'clock in the morning supporting that party on a few times. Another of her many passions started during her younger years, which we all know was learning to play the violin. She was a gifted and self-taught violinist, although during her many hours of practice, her siblings might have disagreed with that. They would vocalize how painful the noise was and that it sounded like squeaks and squawks, and they wished she would just learn to play the piano like her mom did instead. But Dorothy persevered, and it truly paid off. Later in her retirement years, she had the opportunity to play with the Irish Rovers in BC while visiting Bruce and family, and she felt very blessed for the opportunity. I know her siblings were very proud of her accomplishments as well, and obviously Auntie Dot's long hours of practice were rewarded. As this country school only went to grade 9, at age 13, Dorothy boarded in Natton, where she attended the Natton High School. She worked for her room and board, and it wasn't easy, doing all the household chores and trying to get homework done as well. But it was the nature of the times for most if you wanted to further your education. For her last 2 years of school, she shared a bachelor's suite with a friend, and then the following year with her sister Kate in a one-room pad, as she called it. Some of her high school years were difficult due to the fact that she was much younger than the rest of the class, and she got picked on some by the other students, so she didn't socialize too much back in those years, and oftentimes felt very homesick. One year, during the Easter break, she returned home and, to her misfortune, became very ill and was taken to the hospital 35 miles away, where she remained for a week and was diagnosed with double pneumonia. Excuse me, but given the newly discovered drug, penicillin, which she attributed to saving her life, thankfully she recovered, but it was months before she regained her strength. But Auntie Dorothy's fashion, she always praised Alexander Fleming for his discovery. That's just a little of her teaching trivia to share with you. Even in her earliest years, Dorothy wanted to become a teacher. She would play school frequently, so it wasn't too surprising that after completing high school, she went to Calgary Normal School, where she took a shortened teacher training program for 6 months. This was during the war years, about 1942, I believe. And after completing the program, Dorothy was sent out to a rural school 20 miles south of Rocky Mountain House in the Caroline District for a sub-teacher position from January until June. Now picture this. She was 17 years old and attempting to teach children ranging in age from 6 to 16, and not all were very well disciplined. And most of the older boys were much bigger than her, ranging in age from 6 to 16. So on many occasions, she was the recipient of many cruel pranks, threatening to take her outside and snowball her, locking her in the school and having her to go down to the darkened basement and proceed to climb out the basement window, and then finding the window shot out of the school the next day by some of the boys, chalk and brushes missing, maybe a frog or two let go in the classroom or in her desk drawer. Well, you get the picture. But the pranks only stopped when the school year ended. She shed a few private tears during this term, but she persevered and completed her assignment and left with a grade evaluation in hand by the school board. After what seemed to her like an extra long winter and spring, she went to the U of A in Edmonton, where she took a 6-week summer course. I would hope it included a self-defense. I think I would have insisted. While still attending the U of A, she would check the newspaper for a list of soldiers who were returning home from overseas and saw her brother Bill's name. Overwhelmed by the news, she made her plans to take the train to Calgary to meet him. It had been several years since she had been seen him, and it was a great homecoming for both. Dorothy moved back to the Nanton area after completing her course in Edmonton around the fall of 1945. She began teaching at a one-room schoolhouse in the rural district of Clarisome, Alberta. After its closing, she taught at various schools in the area, but many of them were closing, and students were being bused to near-town schools in order to further or obtain their education past grade 9. While teaching in the Star Line School Division, she decided to go back to Nanton for the weekend to attend a dance. Well, she just happened to meet a handsome soldier just back from overseas named Bert Muir. But it wasn't exactly coincidental. Dorothy made a point of introducing herself first and welcoming Bert home and thanking him for serving our country. I'm sure Cupid must have been in the air that night. This was the beginning of their 66-year love story. I may mention that Grandpa Jim Ryan, Dorothy's dad, met Bert at the train station in Calgary upon his return home from overseas, and he jokingly told Bert that he had saved one of his daughters for him. I suppose Grandpa thought that any man that could go to war could certainly hold his own with one of his daughters. You might say they could be a bit strong-willed, maybe even a bit stubborn at times. I believe we've all received some of Grandpa's generics, and that gene seems to be very hereditary. As the saying goes, there's the right way, the wrong way, and the Ryan way. On August 16, 1947, Dot and Bert exchanged their wedding vows at the Central United Church in Calgary, and married life began. They loved and supported each other through the next 66 years until Uncle Bert's passing. Dorothy and Bert were each other's best friends and soulmate, a towering and unshakable love that weathered the hardships, struggles, and storms, and celebrated the incredible joys and special moments that brought them a lifetime of unending adventures and memories. They were married the same year as Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip, and both Auntie Dorothy and Uncle Bert became our personal royal couple. If you've ever read the Queen's book, The Servant, Queen, and the King She Serves, you'll see so many qualities that both Auntie Dorothy and the Queen shared. Dorothy became the matriarch and prayer warrior for both the Ryan and Muir families. I know I can speak for all of us. She made the hardships and joys so much easier with her strength, wisdom, and guidance. Well, maybe there were times when she might have tried to extend too much guidance, but it was always well received. A couple of days after their nuptials, they returned to the farm at Nanton, which Bert had purchased, and as you might guess, the honeymoon was put on hold. It was harvest time. So Dot was soon introduced to farm life. She became an indomitable farm wife who participated in those tasks the pioneer women carried out. She did all the baking for the family, grew a big garden, fed pigs and flocks of chicken, milked cows and made butter, and of course drove tractor during the harvest, along with canning and household chores. But it wasn't all work. Dorothy and Bert were always entertaining family and friends, and of course playing music, and on many occasions, the living room furniture would have to be moved outside to make room for dancing. They didn't have power, gas, or running water, but neither did the neighbors, so everyone lived what you'd call off the grid. But then the power lines were put in, and I'm sure there was a lot of celebrating, but when the, excuse me, but the highlight of Dorothy and Bert's life during those years was the arrival of their four children, Larry, Linda, Bruce, and Kendra. I think it would be safe to say they were model parents. And in the summer months, the farmhouse was filled with the addition of nieces, nephews coming to spend holidays. We were also very grateful to have been raised by such loving and open, generous parents, which included our aunts, uncles, cousins, and we were all just one family. The Ryan Muir Colony was established and is still operating today, each new generation on adding and moving to fun and more memories. Unfortunately, there were many years at Nanton when the weather brought hailstones, droughts, and just poor conditions for farming. During the early 60s, so after a lot of soul searching and tears, the Muirs made one of the hardest decisions of their life to leave the farm, and in 1965, they moved here to Grand Prairie, where both Bert and Dot became employed, Dorothy as a teacher and Bert as a heavy-duty mechanic. It was an emotional time for all, leaving family and friends. With their positive attitudes, they set out on another adventure, which proved to become one of the best choices they had made. It took a while for the Muirs to adjust from the farm life to the city life, which I believe was a population of about 8,000 at that time. But with Dot and Bert's magnetic personalities, it wasn't long before new and lasting friendships were made. Everyone began to settle into their lifestyle. Although they still missed everyone in Nanton, but over the years, many trips were made back to visit. Along with working and raising their family of four, Dot and Bert soon got involved in the community and became friendly faces to many in Grand Prairie and area. And they were blessed with new and lifelong friendships. But in Dot's words, you can take the boy from the country, but you can't take the country from the boy. This proved true. Bert looked around the country each spring to find an acreage to purchase. Then in 1972, they purchased 7 acres of bush land 5 miles from Grand Prairie. It was a family project, I believe, to clear the bush. And then Bert, with the help of son Bruce, put together a Nelson home and moved out to what they referred to as the Ponderosa. It became a very familiar name to family and friends, as Bruce and Kendra had mentioned. And there were so many special occasions held at their hot spot, and special times and special memories. And then with the addition of Pinky's Palace, it became the venue for the weddings, birthdays, and a favorite place. Always a good laugh, good music, good company, and a campfire for those chillier evenings when late nights might have been unavoidable. Bert and Dot's door was always open, literally. They rarely locked it. You could just walk in, and people often did. Neighbors, friends, immediate family and relatives, and strangers, but of course they didn't stay strangers for long. Everyone knew they had a place to stay for a few minutes, few hours, or a few days, even a few months. Boarders soon became family, and friends of the Muir kids soon became part of the family, and Aunt Annie Dorothy became a mother figure to so many. As the immediate Muir clan grew with the addition of son and daughter-in-laws, grandchildren and great-grandchildren, each one was welcomed with unconditional love. Many things evolved around the kitchen table, special occasions, which always included a delicious meal, visiting, homework, reading the Bible, crib games, and she was a formidable opponent, especially against Bert. All enjoyed the hospitality, a cup of coffee, a glass of wine, and of course the home-cooked meals and always fresh baked goodies. But Annie Dot and Uncle Bert's, it's hard to keep them singular because they were always such a couple, so you just kind of have to speak of both of them. Their kindness, generous hearts is what brought everyone back to their table. Dot and Bert loved traveling and went on different destination trips such as Hawaii, Eastern Canada, BC, and even took a train trip to BC, just to mention a few, as well as local camping places during their retirement years, and always enjoyed their travels. But there was a catch. Annie Dot only wanted to be away so long before she headed home. And the return trip didn't exceed the time allotted to be away. We nicknamed her the homing pigeon, and homing truly was where her heart was. As I mentioned prior, Annie Dot excuse me, loved music and played for the Wild Rose Band here in Grand Prairie for many years. She also entered many local violin contests, which you'll see her trophies on the table today, and brought home some much-deserved trophies, as well as playing in the Fiddler's Jamboree. The music that was played before the service and will be played later is from one of the jamborees Annie Dot played in. The Wild Rose Group played for many different functions, weddings, birthdays, at the Legion Senior Lodges, which was a very special place for Annie Dorothy. And although Uncle Bert was her biggest fan, and he used to jokingly say, "How many husbands send their wives to town to fiddle around?" There's a story about Auntie's tapping her toes while playing the violin, but we'll save that for another time. But I would like to share with you a couple of stories about Annie Dorothy. She always loved a good joke and a reason to laugh, so I thought I'd leave you with a couple of her stories. Well, living in the country always brings about uninvited varmints, mice, weasels, and then there's squirrels. Some of you might remember Annie Oakley, an American sharpshooter. Well, she would have been no competition for Dead-Eyed Dot and her squirrel gun. Rumor has it that she didn't always hit her target, so maybe the squirrels were safer than you think. But the same can't be said about some of the outer buildings. Yes, Dead-Eyed Dot, ready to shoot, aimed, and the squirrel kept running. But grandson Chris's window in his holiday trailer wasn't so lucky. Well, Dot couldn't figure out what happened. The bullet must have ricocheted. And that was only once. Maybe the first once. But according to family, there's still a few bullet holes in different places, including Pinky's palace. That's always been a mystery as to how it got there. Just saying, there's someone there out there that knows. And the story about plant hangers and night sweats. It's a little hard to write it down here, so I'm going to try to do it. But the scene starts out around 1 a.m., and Uncle Bert was sound asleep. Annie Dot, in the season of hot flashes and night sweats, got up to open the window and was standing getting some cool air. The moon was shining through the window, and Bert woke up hearing some noise and saw Annie Dot with a rope around her neck. He grabbed the rope, threw her down on the bed to save her life. He thought the midlife crisis had overtaken Dot, and she was trying to hang herself. Dot thought Bert was having a nightmare about the war when he was back in the war and had gone mad and was delirious. So while she was trying to get out of his clutches, he kept trying to calm her down. Well, it wasn't long before the laughter started and the scene changed. The beautiful macrame plant hanger in the window had been the culprit for all the commotion. It definitely wasn't your typical romantic evening, but it truly shows what true love does. It's impossible to forget someone who gave us so much to remember. Thanks for the great times, great food, great music, and great memories. We will miss you for the laughter, the music, advice, prayers to keep us safe, phone calls for the books we shared. We'll miss you because you were you and the ways you touched our lives, ways that cannot be defined by words. Safe home, Annie Dot. Safe home until we meet again. Thank you. I needed that extra Annie Dorothy hug today. So at this time, you don't have to listen to me for a while. The family will be sharing a slideshow of some of their favorite pictures and memories of Annie Dorothy and family, accompanied by some of her favorite songs and musical selections.
You're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But things change when you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, you're never alone. For the God on the mountain easy when life's at its best. Now it's down in the valley of trials and temptations. That's where your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the jewels, his loved and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adorning, they shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown. Gather the gems for his kingdom, all the pure ones, all the bright ones, his loved and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adorning, they shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown. Little children who love their Redeemer are the jewels, precious jewels, his loved and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adorning, they shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown. Shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown. know the pain. You weren't afraid to face the devil. You were no stranger to the rain. So go rest high on that mountain. Son, your work on earth is done. Go to heaven to shout. Love for the Father and the Son. Oh, how we cried the day you left us. Gathered round your grave to grieve. Wish I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high on that mountain. Son, your work on earth is
Happy birthday, Mom.
Thank you. And somebody asked me to give them
some
wisdom.
Yes.
Just number one, love one another.
Hallelujah.
Love one another. Right? Okay.
Are you on the camera? Are you on the camera, Gigi? Mom?
Happy birthday.
What if we cover
this? Ooh, that's pretty good.
Those are some beautiful, beautiful memories, that's for sure. Some of these pictures, you might have to get the stories for them later. I think that one there where Bert was showing a little bit of skin, that was pretty interesting. And so I think, you know, pictures do speak louder than words. And so take too many pictures, laugh too much, and enjoy each other's moments. If we could just take a moment to bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we take a moment today to remember and thank you for the gift of Annie Dorothy's life and for each precious moment that we shared with her. We ask for your strength as we move forward without our loved one and friend. Annie Dorothy's departure isn't easy, Lord, but we know the fullness of your promise for eternity. We don't see your children die. You only see them come home. May we always pray to have eyes that see the best in people, a heart that forgives, and a soul that never loses faith in the Lord. I pray that your peace and presence will be family and friends during this time. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, I would like to invite Herb Dalen, Bill Littleton, and Brianne Beagle, their friends of the Muirs, to come forward and play the song, A Shack in Farewell, as a tribute to Annie Dorothy. The song is usually played as a good night waltz at the end of an evening of music and dancing. I mean, how appropriate for Annie Dorothy. And as we listen to the music, take a moment and reflect back on your own personal memories of Dorothy. I know we all have many. Thank you for such a personal, loving tribute that you have blessed us with in memory of your fellow musician and friend. Annie Dot would be full of praise for your talents and tribute on her behalf. Music definitely speaks to the soul. And I'm sure that each one of us here that knew Annie Dorothy and Uncle Bert could just picture them waltzing around heaven right now. So I guess we should have got up and used the back of the hall and did our own waltz. Just a couple little things here at the end. I am traveling empty-handed. I think this is what Auntie Dorothy would like us to know. But in my heart, I am carrying the love of those who loved me and the warmth of those who cared and the happiness and memories that we shared. They are the treasures of my heart. So as I travel on this journey without you by my side, I'll embrace all my family and friends that I have known. I will cherish your love, laughter, fun. They will all go with me. They will continue to make my spirit glow so long as love and hope and dreams abide in earth and sky. Although I am gone, we can't see each other's faces, but we will still be together. So go to the beach, make footprints of your own, share a glass of wine, listen to music, sit by a campfire. Use the tools you have to help others. Travel, enjoy the beauty of Mother Nature, and walk in faith. Remember, life is not about the steps you've taken, but the footprints you've left behind. A favorite quote of Annie Dot's was, "Remember, if you can't do great things, do small things in a great way." A butterfly lights beside us like a sunbeam, and for a brief moment, its glory and beauty belong to our world. But then it flies again, gone, never to be forgotten. And though we wish it could have stayed, we feel blessed to have shared the beauty. The family will be having an private interment at a later date. But at this time, if I could ask everyone to please stand as they are able, the family will be showing their gesture of love to Annie Dot by the laying of roses. And after the immediate family has paid their respects, family and friends are invited to come forward for your own personal time with her. Please stay and join the family afterwards for refreshment. This will conclude our tribute to Dorothy today, and may the Creator always walk beside you. And as we listen to Annie Dorothy's music, we will hear her play for her family and her farewell to them. Thank you.